Hello viewers, welcome to today's edition of the program Environment and You. Today we'll be taking a walk to the farm to see the effect of armyworm on our crops, especially the maize. I am your host, Ada Achanya. A walk to a farmland at Nabda, where we'll be speaking with the country coordinator of Open Forum on Agricultural Biotechnology in Africa.
Hey, my name is Dr. Rose Maxwell Gidado. I'm the country coordinator of Open Forum on Agricultural Biotechnology in Africa, Nigeria chapter. Oh, okay. The armyworm is a green striped larva of the insect armyworm. It means that it's the larva of the armyworm that attacks the maize plant when it is growing. When it's about flowering, you could see the effects it has caused on this. This plant now cannot produce anymore. And it's not just here, I mean on this plant. So many of the plants around here, look at it. The maize cups around here, no more maize cup. Everything the farmer is going to lose, and he has spent a lot of money. According to him, he said he has sprayed this farm about 3 to 4 times, and there's no effect on the liver of the armyworm. The armyworm is still there, and is doing very well. To eat, this is food. It's also struggling for food, so the chemicals are no longer efficacious against this worm. The worm has grown resistance to the chemicals, and that is why the scientists have gone further to develop a maize that is water efficient maize for Africa. Okay. It is WEMA. It was developed for drought tolerance, so that maize can be grown in areas where there is no water, there's little rain. But it was discovered recently when trials were conducted in East Africa. It was discovered that the maize, was resistant to armyworm. And that is an added advantage. It's an unintended benefit. And so if we have this maize in other parts of Africa where farmers are suffering, it will go, you know, a long way in empowering them, because the liver would no longer attack their plants, their crops any longer, and productivity will be high. If you look at this farm, look at it, almost half of it, what he has planted, is gone. How much is he going to make? He can't. There's even no hope, because look at it, look at the worm here. It has ravaged this crop. Everything about this plant is gone. The flowers are gone, and once the flowers are gone, you can't get anything. And this is what we are seeing. Go to the farmer's field and see for yourself. It's good that you're here. You have seen. You are not hearing, or you are not watching on television, but you are seeing it live. You've seen what the farmers are. You can look at the farmers, see them. Looking at them, they are poor. They are peasant farmers, and this is just for them to feed their families. They can't even have, you know, anything from here. What they will get from here will just end up feeding them maybe for a few months. But the next planting season, they are out of food. That is what we're saying. We need technologies, pervasive technologies, technologies like the genetic modification tool that can really take the farmer out of this slavery. This is slavery, because every year he experiences the same thing. Because the larva itself, the insects themselves, with time, because they are used to these chemicals, so they mutate, their genes mutate, their genes change, and they get used to the chemicals. And some of them, it doesn't do anything to them. So, but with this technology, that's why the scientists keep on, the breeders keep on carrying out research on how to make, you know, farming attractive, how to make it a business. And how do you make it a business? Of course, you can't make it a business without the use of technology. So the use of technology cannot be overemphasized. It is very, very essential to take us out of this poverty, because farming is the mainstay. It's a huge, I mean, it contributes to the economy. And, in Nigeria, in those days, economic diversification. And then the agri is topmost on the agenda. So for us to really attain that, to attain food security, this is what we need. We need technology. All the technology, combination of all, not just the conventional technology.
Okay.
Where the conventional technology fails, like in this case, the use of chemicals in treating the plants. Okay, once it fails, what do you do? You have to go to the genetic level, to the roots of the matter. You have to find out what is it that we need to put in this plant to make this plant resistant to these insects. Of course, it is this tool. Breeders have found it. You know, it's an advancement. And it doesn't, because you have a new technology, it doesn't take the other old one out of it.
Okay.
Any problem that can be solved conventionally is fine by either hybridization or the normal agriculture. Agriculture itself is human activity. Agriculture itself is not a natural thing. It was brought in by man. If you see maize in the wild, how the corn, how it started, it's just like grass. But it's all this modification. Exchange of genes have been there from time immemorial. They have been there, but with time, there has been advancement. You know, as we are having challenges, emerging pests and diseases, the global warming is bringing in a lot of, you know, challenges, especially emergence of new insects, insects you never thought of, insects you never imagined could come, could ravage your crop, could put you out of food. It's a threat to food security. This armyworm is a threat, and it's not just armyworm that you know, attacks corn. There are so many other insects, the pod borer, the stem borer, they are all there, you know. And you know, not just with maize, even with other crops. So we have to rise up to the challenge. Our population is on the increase, you know, the global warming is there, we have problem of a drought coming in, you know, desert encroachment is there. We lose landmass of 350,000 square meters, you know, every year, and that is not funny, you know, and it's approaching, it's growing inwards. So it's not out of place to adopt new technologies that can help us, that can put us out of poverty. We need food in Africa. And the Malabo Declaration, you know, we have to work towards it, so that people will go out of hunger, so that no one goes to bed hungry.
Everything you've said, how can these farmers get this message in the area of sensitization?
These farmers will get, like, we're here now, we are already educating them. We are going to tell them about what breeders have done, like in the case of the WEMA, the water efficient maize. It's, I'm sure we will work towards bringing it, deploying it to Nigeria and other parts of Africa, so that the farmers can benefit. So, but at this stage, it's just to tell them that something is going on, something new is going to come and take them out of this poverty. Even though I know that the Federal Minister of Agriculture is making efforts to maybe come in with new chemicals and show them how they can spray and what to take care of this menace. But then the chemicals are not, it's just a temporary solution. It's not permanent solution. But attacking it at the gene level is the permanent solution, and we need that. And research and development has to continue to go on to really rise up to some of these challenges. And so it's to get to the farmers and sensitize them, and, you know, provide them with evidence-based information, factual information, you know, all the facts and figures, tell them something new is coming. And when it comes, of course, they'll be given the seeds, so that they will try it on their farms and they will see for themselves. Because as you give them the GM seeds, you also have to, they will try it alongside with their own, and so that they will see the difference. Because seeing is believing, and new technology uptake is very difficult. If a farmer is used to his own, it's difficult for you to convince him so it has to be practical. So demonstration, you have to give them the seeds to plant on their fields and see themselves see the crop growing and see the crop growing resistance to the insects. And there he will get convinced, and acceptability of course come in.
When we get talking to farmers, what they will tell you that they are scared that maybe this thing will have side effects on their health. So what's your take on that?
Side effects or risk is always there in life. You have to take risk and so on and so forth. Even with the chemicals, life itself is a risk. Everything is about risk. The chemicals they are spraying, do you know the effects of those chemicals on their chest? They carry this, they spray, they inhale, I mean times without number, every day they do that. The risk is there. So but with the GM crops, because they go through series of tests, safety analysis, safety test. You have to check for the gene of interest you have inserted. You have to be sure that the gene is there and is expressed and the gene is working. And aside from that, then you have to carry out other analysis, and it's based on comparative analysis. Because as you're carrying out analysis on the GM crop, the GM derivative, the conventional counterpart of that crop too, you have to do it side by side right from the field. Once you harvest, you take it to the lab, you feed it to rats and worms to see the effects of it. Does it have any negative effect? If it has negative effect on the rats, of course that means it will have on human being. And that crop would not see the light of the day. So that is it. So you have to, you know, nutritional analysis, the components, the nutritional components, carbohydrate, fats, minerals, vitamins, what, okay. The vitamins in the quantity and the quality in your newly developed seed, is it the same with the conventional counterpart? If you notice there's a difference in anything aside from your gene of insert, that means there's something wrong. Yes, all those, and some of these analyses are carried out by internationally recognized bodies, regulatory bodies. It has to be according to conform to the standards of WHO. It has to conform to the standards of FAO, OECD, and so on and so forth. So safety is being ensured. It's not as easy as we think. It will take you 15 years, 13 to 15 years, for you to come out with a wholesome and safe GM crop or GM food. Because that safety must be ensured before it is released to farmers. And as even it is released to farmers, of course, there will still be testing and, you know, research and development going on. To know as people begin to use, of course some analysis will still be going on, but at any point in time you notice something funny, something different, you have to withdraw it, because you have to ensure that health of humans, health of animals, and then the environment is being taken care of. So environmental sustainability must be maintained. And you see, these chemicals, as they spray, sometimes they destroy everything around the environment. The ecosystem is distorted, so environmental friendliness is not there. And as the rain falls, everything gets to the river. And these farmers, most of them in the villages, in the rural areas, they drink this water without treating it. And it's a risk to their health. But with the use of this technology, of course, all these are being cut down. The use of chemicals is being reduced. And so health risk is reduced as well. It's actually a threat to food security. I don't know. I can't say, because I can't say, yeah, it's a threat to food security. Food might be short, but we have to, I think the Federal Minister of Agriculture is solving that. Yeah, yes, they are rising up to that challenge, okay, to be sure that more farmers are engaged, more farmers are taught on how to use the chemicals, so that the chemicals will be efficacious. Of course, maybe new chemicals are developed to take care of this before we are ready with our genetically modified crops.
Okay.
But I'm not praying that there will be shortage of food.
Okay.
Even though.
What's your advice to our farmers out there and our viewers?
Yeah, the farmers have to actually be working with scientists. They have to voice out themselves. Like, we are here now, we have seen it, and you are also here, the media. They should also work with the media, even though some of them have no access. But we have to really intercede for them, be in the middle between them and the media and the government. Now we have seen, and you're going to show it out, and the government will see and take care of all the problems they have. They have to reach out to say this is what they are going through, so that government can come to their help, so that people can come to their help, and they can also go out looking for new ways of doing it. It's actually the problem is they are not economically empowered.
That's just it, not economically.
He just did like 3 to 4 sprays, but sometimes you have to do like 9 sprays, but he doesn't even have the money to buy the chemicals. So what does he do? So we have to really work hard to see how we can assist them develop new technologies. It's a combination of all mechanization, but with the mechanization, will they afford to buy a tractor? Mechanization makes it easier and makes it, but it's expensive, makes it a business. So we need the help of the government.
Okay. We will now go on a short break. When we return, the program continues. Welcome back. We'll also be speaking with farmers who aired their plight on the effects done on their crops so far.
Mara sa fasalin irin da zamu yi, Allah ya taimake mu mu samu maganin tsutsan nan. Har yanzu mun yi bakin iya kokari. Dan yanzu ma daga feshi nake, ko mun fesa din. Wallahi bai kashewa. Ko mun fesa maganin bai kashewa. Dan in kin lura jikina nan duk ruwa ne ma. Wallahi Allah mun yi feshin amma bai kashe mana tsutsan ba. Mara sa yanda zamu yi. Amma in Allah ya sa, gwamnati tana da hanyar da za ta taimaka mana da maganin da zamu samu. Wanda zai amfani, wanda zai kashe wannan wannan tsutsa, gaskiya muna madalla da shi. Eh, dan ni mi kaina nan ni retire amis ne, amma na bar aikin komai, banda aikin gona ba abin da nake yi. Wallahi to shine yawa, to a taimaka mana saboda manzon Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallama.
Eh, mana maganin wannan tsutsa tun tana karama, tsutsan nan da take damuwar mu har yau dai ba mu gano maganin ta wanda zai kawo mana da ita ba. Amma muna so idan gwamnati tana da wannan magani ta taimaka mana, muna bakin iya kokarin mu game da bangaren noma. To amma ba na kuskuren shi da aka samu kenan na wannan tsutsa. Gwamnati ta taimaka ta ba mu magani. Alhamdulillah.
And they are also calling on the government to come to their aid to have a productive production by next year or this season.
Nagode ma Allah da Allah kawo wa'annan mutane su domin su zo wannan gona tamu da muke fama da tsutsa. Wanda take ci mana masara, tun masara tana karami. Mun nemi magani, mun sa bamu samu sun a gan sun kare ba. Har ya zuwa lokacin da masara ta soma goyo, wani ma inda ta saka goyon karewa zai domin masara ta cinye wurin. Saboda haka muna roko a wurin gwamnati ta taimaka mana, ta san irin maganin da za ta rika saida mana da shi domin kashe wa'annan kwarin masara. Allah samu dace. Ga irin kokken mu kenan a wurin ku ɗan jaridu masu kewawa su ga irin lafiyar noman na masara. Mun gode.
For my viewers out there, thanks for staying tuned. With that advice from our guests, we have come to the end of this week edition on the program Environment and You. For adverts, sponsorship, participation, you can call the numbers on your screen. Join me same time, same station next week. I am your host, Ada Achanya.